What if you want to set up Hackintosh but you're too lazy? Enter OpCore-Simplify, a script that simplifies the creation of the files for OpenCore on your computer. I'm sorry for the bad audio quality, it'll get better later. Anyway, let's get started. We download the repository. Then we extract it. Then you install Python if you haven't already. You can do that by opening the command prompt and just typing Python. If it starts running, you've already got it installed. And you can just run the function quit to exit. Now we run the batch file. And it's gonna download the rest of the files for us. First thing we must do is generate a hardware report for this computer. So you should run this tool on the computer you want to do Hackintosh on. Let's choose the first option. It's going to download another tool. And now export the hardware report. And here we have a quick rundown. All of my hardware is officially supported up to macOS Sequoia, which is the latest version right now, except for the graphics, which is only supported officially up to Monterey. But in this case, we can get around that. The fingerprint reader, of course, is not supported. Let's continue. Now we can select the macOS version. Despite the warning, we can still select a newer version. I'm gonna select the latest one. As it points out, it will require OpenCore Legacy Patcher, not for the bootloader, but for adding back some driver support. Similar to the NVIDIA graphics card that I showed in the other video where I didn't use the script, I didn't even know about it then. It also automatically chose the correct SM BIOS model, customized ACPI patch and kext and SM BIOS model. I don't think it's necessary now, so we can already start building the OpenCore files. It's also going to generate a config file with the serial number and everything. But after it's done, you're not ready to use it yet. We need to use a script called USB Toolbox. It's not included, so let's go and get it. Get the latest release, the one named windows.exe. I learned from experience that it works best when you plug in a device on each USB port. My computer has three USB ports, so I'm gonna plug in three USB flash drives. Although you can plug in any USB device, it doesn't have to be a flash drive. Now we run the USB toolbox. Yes, smart screen, it's okay. And let's do discover ports. And there it is, it found it. It's gonna refresh every 5 seconds, but you can go back when the option is available. Now let's select them. All the relevant ones should be selected because we have something plugged into them. And the ones that are not relevant are unchecked. For example, this port 5 is probably an internal port that is never going to be used, so we'll leave it unchecked. Same for these ones. And the ones that have something plugged into them are already selected. But we did forget an option. Let's go back, change settings, and enable use native classes. Because if you didn't remember, the OpCore Simplify tool tells you to turn that on, so let's do that. Now go back, select the ports and build the kernel extension. Now we have the option to build it. Parsec is a remote desktop tool which has its virtual USB adapter. We can ignore it. And now it asks for a model identifier. You could type it in, but just to be safe, I'm gonna copy and paste it. And there we go. I'm going to unplug all these flash drives. And here's our new kext folder. On macOS it's a file, but over here it's a folder. We'll put it with the rest of the kernel extensions. So it's EFI, OC, kexts. And now we have to update the config.plist file to make it aware of that kext file we just added, as the screen says. And to do that automatically and safely, we use another script called ProperTree, which you also use when configuring OpenCore manually. This one doesn't have a release, so you just get it by downloading the repository, like we did with OpCore-Simplify. Put it there. Run the batch file on Windows. Now we open our config.plist. And then run an OpenCore snapshot. You go to File, OC Snapshot, or press Ctrl-R. Not an OC clean snapshot, just a regular snapshot. It asks you to select the OC folder. It's already there, so just select folder. And there it is. It appears that nothing's changed, but if we scroll down, the USB kext file should be somewhere in here, USB map, which wasn't there before. So now we can save that file. And while we're here, we should also make another pretty important change. Under root, let's collapse these sections until we get to miscellaneous. Then under boot, we find hide auxiliary. Double click on false and set it to true. This will hide the options that are less important, such as the recovery drive and also the reset NB RAM option, which you should never pick. Because on some computers, including this ThinkPad, there's a risk it will permanently brick the computer. And now we can save again. And close ProperTree. Now our OpenCore files are ready. So we can quit the OpCore Simplify tool. And now we have to set up an installation flash drive. I used my other computer running macOS. I formatted a flash drive using the GUID Partition Table. Then I created a bootable macOS installer. So I'm not sure exactly how you're supposed to do it without a computer already running macOS. Anyway, I'm going to plug in my install USB flash drive now, which has to be at least 32GB if you're going to use Sonoma. 16GB is no longer enough, unless you chose an older macOS version. Windows is going to ask to format it because it doesn't recognize the file system. That's okay. We want access to EFI partition, which is FAT32. Now here's the command to mount an EFI partition on Windows. Let's open PowerShell as administrator. So first we have to see the number of the disk and partition, and we can do that with diskpart. Let's list the disks. Disk 0 is our internal drive. Disk 1 is the flash drive. So we know it's disk 1, but where is the EFI partition? Let's select that disk and list its partitions. And it seems that the EFI partition is partition 1. So knowing those numbers, we can type this PowerShell command. Disk number 1, partition number 1. As for access path, you just have to choose a drive letter. I have these letters occupied from network drives, so I'm going to choose E. And there we go, it assigned the drive letter. But we still can't access it. Even if you click on continue, nothing. And you cannot use the security tab because FAT32 doesn't have that kind of permissions. We have to access the EFI partition using another file manager. For example, 7-zip. FM stands for File Manager. And here we can open it. There's the EFI partition. Now I've already set it up in the past, but I'm gonna add these new files I just created to see if they work. So this was the file for my 2009 MacBook Pro, and this is the file for this ThinkPad. Let's rename that folder. And now you can't just drag these because you're running 7-zip as administrator. So we have to open another 7-zip instance and go to our OpCore results folder and drag the files to the EFI folder from here. Files from the boot folder are probably the same. Now it's going to transfer the OC folder. And there we go. Obviously you're not going to have these two old folders, but now the USB installation flash drive is set up. So let's boot to it and let's see if the macOS installer starts. Okay, let's restart now. Let's quickly enter the BIOS options. So the only options to change are the security chip. It should not be active. See, this computer has DPM 2.0, even though it doesn't officially support Windows 11. And secure boot should be disabled. And also in this particular computer, even though we're booting only with UEFI, CSM support should be enabled. Otherwise the screen is garbled. So let's exit and boot to the flash drive. There it is. It also has this pretty cool theme. Now as you can see, I've already got it installed, but now let's boot to the installer. It's gonna show a lot of things. Let's just wait until it's done. If it starts up successfully, that is. And look at that, it worked. At this point, you can go to Disk Utility, go to View, Show All Devices, and you can select the partition you want to install macOS to, or erase the entire drive, it's up to you. Just be careful, of course. Always have your important files backed up. In this case, I have a secondary partition, which I already created, formatted as APFS, and it created this container for me, and I already installed Sequoia to it. So I'm not gonna do it again. Or once you got your partition set up, you can just begin installing. In this case, I'm gonna shut down. And by the way, when you're installing, you should always continue booting from the USB flash drive, because at that point, the OpenCore bootloader is only there. And in fact, that's what I'm gonna do right now too. Even though it's installed to the hard drive, the bootloader is still only on the flash drive. We select the Mac partition. And there it is. Obviously in this case it's not my first boot, but it is the first boot with the bootloader we just set up. So I'm glad to see that works. I haven't signed into my Apple ID or Apple account, so it doesn't matter that the serial number is different. The only tweak I've done to this installation was install the Retina display mod. And as you might be able to see, it's actually not that fast on this computer. This is the first macOS version I've seen on this 2013-2014 ThinkPad that is a little sluggish. Monterey was a lot faster than this. Anyway, and we run into another issue. Even though it set up the kernel extension for the Intel wireless, it doesn't appear to work on Sequoia. It's grayed out. Maybe it's not set up correctly. I doubt it though, because it did download the latest kernel extension. So we have to connect via Ethernet. And after connecting via Ethernet, the network should work. And there it is, the one key HiDPI. By the way, the track point with the middle button and left and right, as well as the trackpad with two fingers to scroll, work just fine, which is great. There's this mod. You just download the repository and run the command and follow the instructions. I just did enable HiDPI for MacBook Pro and chose a 1080p display. The volume hotkeys work. Even mute. But the brightness keys don't. Even though it is possible to adjust the brightness from the system settings.
And here's the screen recording.
And of course, you saw in the OpCore-Simplify script that the graphics required OpenCore Legacy Patcher. So after the OS is installed, you download and install the OpenCore Legacy Patcher, run it, and apply the post-install root patch. And even though it requires this OpenCore Legacy Patch, Metal Graphics Acceleration works. Oh, and there's a new version too. I'll install it later. So there's the post-install root patch. We don't need to use this program for the bootloader. So there's the new macOS Sequoia wallpaper that requires Metal Graphics Acceleration. It's probably generating those wavy lines or whatever. And there's another one, Macintosh, which is animated. And you can adjust the colors. Right now it's even slower because I'm screen recording. Or just choose another wallpaper that doesn't require metal, like this one. Oh yeah, and Sequoia also introduces window snapping. Just like Windows 7 had, 15 years ago. After making sure your Hackintosh setup is working correctly, you can transfer OpenCore to your internal drive, so you don't need your USB drive to boot to macOS every time. I've already quickly shown how to do that in my Big Sur video, and it's also explained in the OpenCore setup guide. Here's the About screen. And another issue with Hackintosh is that the keyboard modifier keys may be wrong, not just this computer. It can also happen on real Macs if you use a non-Apple keyboard. I don't remember where the setting is on this new System Settings app. But if you look up modifier, you should be able to find it. Customize modifier keys. Here it is. And on non-Apple keyboards, you have to swap the Option and Command keys. Option, also known as Alt. But after that, you press Alt-Q on an Apple keyboard, and it quits. So that's about it. I'm not going to keep this installation. It's quite slow, and I don't want to set up everything. But thanks to the OpCore-Simplify script, it was really easy to try. A very cool creation. Thank you for watching.